electromagnetic fields, electromagnetism, an overview, second one of the three parts, series on electromagnetic field theory, lecture number 0.00. Electromagnetic field theory is also called field theory or wave theory in short. It is a core subject in electrical engineering. In fact, it is core of the core for the study of electrical engineering. The generation of electrical energy, its transmission, its distribution, all these aspects are based on electromagnetic field theory or wave theory. In communication engineering, the functioning of antenna, the design of antenna, it is all based on radiation, which is an important property of dynamic electromagnetic waves. One cannot imagine any wireless communication system without antennas. From this, it is not difficult to understand how much importance the electromagnetic field theory carries in communication engineering. Now, it is planned to give an overall view of electromagnetic field theory. This view is organized in three parts. In the present session, that is second session, the focus is on static fields, electrostatic fields, and steady magnetic fields, mainly on their contents. In both the cases, the starting point is force, and then field intensity, displacement or flux, potentials, boundary conditions, energy storage capacities, etc., etc. They are all described. Now we move on to the actual presentation. A few points regarding electrostatic fields or electrostatics. We all know learning is a process which starts with known quantities and moving towards the knowledge of unknown quantities. Here also, the study starts with known quantity. Force is a concept that is well known to us. The starting point is force. The force that exists between two charges. There exists force. It is known to mankind since several centuries back. This force is described by a law analytically. That law is Coulomb's law. The starting point of electrostatics is Coulomb's law, which describes the force, electric force. From force, we slowly drift towards the concept of field. Field is new. We start with force and we drift from force to field, connecting force with field. While in the field intensity of the field is introduced, and an expression for it is also derived from Coulomb's law. Then we move to displacement. Displacement is a new idea, a new concept. There are two concepts entirely new in field theory. They are field, another is displacement. In electric fields, it is called a displacement. In magnetic field theory, it is called flux. The concept of displacement is associated with Gauss law. So through Gauss law, displacement is introduced, and also the concept of flux lines. Then potential. In case of electric fields, it is scalar potential. In case of magnetic fields, you are going to see it is vector potential. The quantity potential, it is defined and introduced after Gauss law, and the differentiation between absolute potential and relative potential, it is explained. Laplace equation is not specific to electromagnetic field theory. One can find it in other branches of engineering too. Example, in mechanical engineering, one can find. But here, Laplace equation involving scalar potential, it is introduced. Then energy storage. Fields are reservoirs of energy. They contain energy. What is the source of energy? This energy, where this energy has come from, in what way this energy content is related to field intensity, all those aspects are explained under energy storage. Then boundary conditions. Let us suppose there are two media with an interface in between them. The fields across the interface, they are related. That relation is given under boundary conditions. There are materials Broadly, they are divided into three categories: conductors, semiconductors, dielectrics. The division is based on electrical conductivity. If conductivity is very large, then they are conductors. When conductivity is small or nil, then they are dielectrics. When conductivity is in between conductors and dielectrics, then they are semiconductors. Under materials, properties of conductors, properties of dielectrics, they are studied. Polarization is an important phenomenon pertaining to dielectrics. We come across this term at two places in electromagnetic field theory. Once in electrostatics, there it is called dielectric polarization, and once in wave theory, there it is called wave polarization. Polarization is specific to dielectrics. It refers to a phenomena where certain charges, charge distributions are created. The specialty is half of the charges positive, half of the charges negative, and when we consider the total body, it is neutral. Then capacitance. Capacitance is a basic electrical quantity. It is introduced to the students in the beginning of the course in circuit theory. There, the introduction is through voltage and current, circuit theory quantities. But here, it is introduced through field quantities. Now, a few points regarding charge distributions. It has been told to you, electrostatics is the study of regions surrounding stationary charge distributions. Stationary means not moving. Distribution means shape. There are broadly two types of charge distributions. One is discrete, another is continuous. In continuous, there are three types: line charge, surface charge, and volume charge. Single or group of point charges belong to the first category, whereas, as already mentioned, line, surface, and volume charge belong to second category. Then what is point charge? Point charge is one whose size is negligibly small. That's all. Here is shown all the four types of charge distributions. In A, one can find discrete charge distribution. Here several point charges: Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, etc., etc., Qn, several point charges. Notice the size. It is not the amount of the charge. It is the size of the charge that is negligible. The charge can be any amount. It can be 100 coulombs. It can be 2000 coulombs. It doesn't matter. But the size must be negligibly small. The size must be equal to the size of point geometrical entity. Now in B is shown a line charge. In C is shown a sheet charge. In D is shown a volume charge. In B, you can see it is in the form of a line. If you consider a small length DL, the charge within this length DL, DL stands for differential length. The charge within differential length, it is usually designated by DQ. This DQ is, one can easily understand, it is charge density, that is charge per unit length into length of the differential charge, that is DL. Charge per unit length, it is designated with the symbol lambda. It is called a line charge density. It may be uniform, non-uniform, it doesn't matter. So DQ is lambda DL. If we want a total charge over this line, then we have to perform integration. Q is integral DQ, integration over the entire length, lambda DL. Now let us come to sheet charge. Consider a small area dA, differential area. The charge over this differential area, it is called differential charge and indicated by DQ. It can be found by multiplying dA, area, with charge per unit area, sigma. Sigma is surface charge density. It denotes charge that exists within one unit area. If we want total charge over the sheet, then we have to perform integration, surface integration. Q is integral DQ sigma dA. Similarly, volume charge. Here is shown a differential volume d tau. The charge within this differential volume, it is called differential charge, and as usual, as is done in the previous cases, it is indicated by DQ. If we want the charge within this differential volume, we can get it by multiplying d tau with rho. Rho is charge density, it is charge per unit volume. If we want total charge, then we have to perform integration over the entire volume over dq. So q is integral dq, it is integration over volume rho dt. It is triple integral. One point it is required to be mentioned here, in all the three cases, in B, C and D, the size of differential charge, it is small. It is so small, we consider it as a point charge. This aspect has to be kept in mind while studying field theory. Now a few points regarding line charge. It is a kind of reminding, already I mentioned all the points. Shape of the charge is in the form of a thin line. It has only the length dimension with no area or volume, we can see very easily. The charge per unit length, uniform or otherwise, is usually indicated by symbol lambda. Units are coulombs per meter. The charge within a differential length dl, called differential charge, it is dq equal to lambda dl. Total charge L can be obtained from the differential charge using the relation q is integral L lambda dl. Few points regarding surface charge. Charge exists in the form of a thin sheet. This distribution has both length and width dimensions but no thickness. Charge per unit area is indicated by sigma. It can be uniform or non-uniform, and its units are coulombs per square meter. Differential charge dq, charge that is charge within differential area dA, it becomes dq equal to sigma dA. Total charge is integration over sigma dA. The region of integration is over the entire volume. Here he is mentioning differential charge can be considered as a point charge. As already mentioned, the size is so small. Differential length is so small. Differential area is so small. Differential volume is so small. In case of line charge, in case of surface charge, in case of volume charge respectively, that so that we can consider those charges as point charges. Volume charge. The charge occurs in the form of a solid having arbitrary shape but with finite volume. Distribution can have all the three dimensions. Length dimension is there, width dimension is there, thickness dimension is also there. Charge per unit volume is usually indicated by rho. It may be uniform or non-uniform. Dimensions are, as already mentioned, coulombs per meter cube. Differential charge dq now becomes rho d tau. Total charge within a volume V is integration over rho d tau. Region of integration is over the charge volume. Now we move to second part of the first division, study magnetic fields. Before going further, one point is required to be mentioned. The sequence of the topics we study in study magnetic fields is the same as the sequence of the topics we study in static electric fields. Then we started with force, then we went to field, then field intensity, then flux or displacement, then potentials, then Laplace equation, boundary conditions. Here also same sequence. And while studying, while going through study magnetic fields, you can notice lot of similarity between expressions to force expressions, field intensity expressions, displacement flux expressions, potential expressions, Laplace equation expressions, boundary conditions, storage, materials. Everywhere you can notice similarity, not sameness, not equal, but plenty of connectedness, plenty of closeness, plenty of correlation, both in concepts and also expressions. Now, starting point in the study of steady magnetic fields is force. It is described by Lorentz force law. Another law is also there, Ampere's force law. But starting point is Lorentz force law. Then the topic is field intensity. It is studied, it is understood with the help of Biot-Savart law. Before going further, one aspect regarding magnetic field intensity is required to be mentioned. Electric field intensity has a meaning. It is force per unit charge. Magnetic field intensity has no such meaning. No such physical concept idea is associated with magnetic field intensity. But it is useful in understanding magnetic fields. In field theory, we also come across such quantity once again in magnetic vector potential. Electric scalar potential has a meaning. Magnetic vector potential, it doesn't have any such meaning. It is purely a mathematical quantity. It is useful quantity in the analysis of fields. Okay, then we move to magnetic flux. It is already mentioned, displacement in electric fields is called flux in magnetic fields. It is associated with the Ampere's circuital law. Ampere's circuital law, it has lot of similarity with Gauss law in electrostatics. Then potentials. In steady magnetic fields, vector potentials are there, scalar potentials are also there. Each one has its own applications. They are useful at different places. They are introduced, they are defined, and they are studied. And then we move to Laplace's equation. Then boundary conditions. What are boundary conditions? Boundary conditions connect fields across the interface of two different media. Energy storage, as already mentioned, fields are reservoirs of energy. Magnetic fields are also, when I say fields, both electric fields and magnetic fields. So a study is undertaken to explore the origin of the energy, the magnetic field, and the connecting relation between field intensity and energy stored. Then magnetic materials. Basically, three types are there. Other types are also there, but mainly they are three: dia, para, ferro. Magnetization is a quality of magnetic materials. It is somewhat similar to polarization. Then inductance. Inductance is one of the three basic electrical quantities. It is in magnetic fields similar to capacitance in electric fields. It is defined, introduced, and explained in terms of field quantities in electromagnetic field theory under steady magnetic fields. As already mentioned, magnetic fields are regions surrounding current distributions. Suppose some current is flowing through a conductor. Let us suppose DC. The region surrounding this particular conductor, it is called steady magnetic field. So currents are sources of magnetic fields. Three types of currents are there. Filamentary current. Current which is in the form of a thin line. See, a thin, very thin conductor is there and some current is flowing through it. This current is called filamentary current. The current that is flowing through the conductor is simply, it is measured in amperes. Symbol is I. Surface current. The current here is in the form of a thin sheet. Current per unit length. So let us suppose here is a sheet, a conductor sheet, some current is flowing like this. And let us also suppose total current is I. Now, consider the dimension that is normal to the current flow. Let us suppose it is L. Now, I by L is called current density or surface current density. It is indicated by K. Units are amperes per meter. Volume current. Current is in the form of a solid rod. Volume current density is indicated by J. Units are amperes square meter or square meter. What is volume current? You consider a very thick rod like this. Suppose some current is flowing like this. Total current is I. You consider the area normal to the current flow. In case of surface current also, we considered the dimension normal to the current flow. Here also we have to consider the area normal to the current flow. Let us suppose this area is A. Total current divided by A. It is indicated by volume current density. Symbol is A. Units are, of course, amperes per square meter. Here is shown a relation. This relation is used one or two places in the analysis of magnetic fields. So it is required to be there in the minds. Integral J d tau, integral K dA, integral I dl. I means current, differential length. K means surface current density, differential area. J means volume current density, differential volume. So IDL can be replaced by KDA, can be replaced by JD tau, but it is not a blind replacement. We have to do it wisely. Now, these three differentials, they are connected to QV. What is Q? Q is charge, V is velocity. Notice, what is current? Flow of charge. Flow means with some speed or velocity. So charge is there, velocity is also there in the current. Q refers to that charge, V refers to the velocity of the charge. These two quantities, product of these two quantities can also be connected to Idl, Kda, J, D tau. Current distributions are shown here. This is filamentary current. This is surface current. This is volume current. This is K, Di by Dl, J, Di by Da. The definitions that are given in the earlier slide, they assume uniform current over the conducting sheet or over the conducting thick wire. Here the definitions are most general. K equal to Di by Dl perpendicular. J equal to Di by Da perpendicular. These definitions are applicable even when the current is non-uniform. This is part 2. Hope you have a beautiful, enriching learning experience. See you soon in part 3. Enough for now.